Hi there and welcome to another session of Business Studies with me, Vishwanath sir, for the 12th standard. We are now at the principles of management where we covered the first three principles of Fayol out of his 14 principles. We covered the principles of discipline, authority and responsibility and discipline. Okay, so right now we shall go ahead with the fourth discipline, with the fourth principle. And take it from there how much ever we can complete in this particular session. So your fourth principle is unity of command. Okay, and this is a very it's very easy to understand. And he tells, Fayol tells, that there should be only one and only one boss for an individual employee. Okay, dual subordination should be avoided. So a person shouldn't be reporting to two bosses. He should be reporting only to one boss. The principle of unity of command states that each participant in a formal organization should receive orders from and be responsible only to one superior. So he should be only taking orders from one boss, not from two, three bosses. There will be a lot of confusion for that employee and he is going to break down soon. Okay, and what will happen is that many of the jobs might not happen in this process. Okay, so the principle of unity of command states that each participant in a formal organization should receive orders and be responsible for one superior only. Let's take an example. A salesperson is asked to clinch a deal with the buyer and is allowed to give 10% discount by the marketing manager. But the finance department tells him that not to offer more than 5% discount. Now there is no unity of command. They can only be avoided if there is coordination between the various departments. So in this process, the salesperson gets grinded in between. So the instructions have to match with each of the departments, like to why is it 10%, why is it 5%, and they should work out to a amicable decision. Okay. Now let's see the positive effect of this principle. The principle of unity of command helps to prevent confusion regarding the task to be done. So if you are clear cut with all your terms and conditions, it becomes clear for the person to follow it. Other thing, the consequences of violation of this principle. If the employee gets order from two or more superiors at the same time, the principle of unity of command is violated. Fayol felt that if this principle is violated, the authority is undermined, the discipline is in jeopardy, the order is disturbed, and the stability is threatened. Okay? So these are four negative effects that could come out if you are not following the unity of command, where the authority is undermined, the discipline is in jeopardy, the order is disturbed, and the stability is threatened. Okay, so that is unity of command for you. That was your fourth principle. We go to the fifth principle, which is the unity of direction. First was unity of command, now unity of direction. All the units and divisions of an organization should be moving towards the same objectives through coordinated and focused efforts. Okay, each group having the same objectives must have one head and one plan. Okay, so there has to be a concrete understanding between all of them. Example, if a company is manufacturing motorcycles as well as cars, then it should have two separate divisions for them, each division having its own in charge plans and execution resources. Okay, on no account should the working of the two departments or the two divisions overlap each other. Okay, so then example here, if a company is manufacturing motorcycles as well as cars, then there should be two separate divisions for both of them. Each division should have its own in charge plans and execution resources, and on no account should the working of these two divisions overlap. Okay, so the positive effects is the overlapping will not be there and it ensures action and coordination. Let's quickly go through the differences between the unity of command and unity of direction on the basis of their meaning, aim and implications. On the basis of meaning, one subordinate should receive the orders from one and only one who is responsible to one, only one superior. Unity of direction, same objective should be done with one head and one plan. Unity of command, aim is to prevent dual subordination. While as unity of direction means it prevents overlapping of activities. Implications, it affects the individual employee, and in case of unity of direction, it affects the entire organization. So that was unity of command for you, and in this process we go from the fifth principle to the sixth principle. We finish today with unity of command and unity of direction. Now we come to the next principle, which is known as subordination of individual interest to general interest. Now when you're trying to do this, you should be working towards a common goal of the organization. The organization is the most important aspect from what you're working. You should be seeing that you perform your best for the organization, because you are appointed by the organization for a particular purpose. Okay, so this is subordination of individual interest to general interest, where the interest of an organization should take priority over the interest of any individual employee. Okay, besides this, a manager should ensure that his or her exemplary behavior should not, you know, fall into the temptation of misusing his power or power of powers for this family or benefit cost. Because of the cost of one large interest of the workers, this will raise the stature in the eyes of the workers and at the same time ensure behavior from both of them. Okay, so let's take an explanation here. Every worker has some or the other individual interest from a company. The company has got its own objectives. For example, the company wants maximum output from the employees at a competitive price. On the other hand, an employee may want to get maximum salary while working the least. In another situation, the individual employee may demand some concession which is not as admissible to the others too. So this is in the larger interest of the workers and the stakeholders to be more important in the interest of the company. For the interest of the stakeholder, that is the owners, creditors, debtors, financiers, tax authority, there are other people to, you know, go about doing it. Okay, so from here we go through the next principle, which is the principle of remuneration to the employees. The overall pay and the commission should be fair to both the employees and the organization. The employees should be paid fair wages and at least give them a reasonable, which will give them a reasonable standard of living. Okay, at the same time, it should be within the paying capacity of the company. Of course, if the company cannot afford, it will not make any sense paying the employees. Okay, so the overall pay of the organization should be fair to both the employees and the managers. Okay, so that the positive effects is there will be a congenial atmosphere, good relation among the workers and management, and finally there will be the working of the company will be smooth. I go to the next principle, which is known as centralization and decentralization. centralization decision making is by only one authority, which does with the dispersal of one person, that is decentralization. According to Fayol, there is a need to balance subordinate involvement through decentralization. Okay, the managers retain the final authority through centralization. The degree of centralization or decentralization depends upon the circumstances in which the general organizations dwell. Okay, so this organizations have decentralization and more deal with this decentralization than small organization. So these were the 8 points which we discussed. We've got another 6 points more to discuss. Thank you so much for being there today. This is Vishwanath sir signing off.